Major funding for the production of Making Sense New England has been made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting, the Foundation for Financial Planning, a nonprofit organization helping people take control of their financial lives through financial literacy education, and the pro bono outreach of the financial planning community. The FINRA Investor Education Foundation, helping investors ask questions and check investments before they invest. Online at saveandinvest.org. Goodwill, helping to stretch budgets since 1933. Online at goodwillnne.org.
Hi, I'm Jennifer Rooks, and this is Making Sense New England. Welcome to Making Sense New England, a series about the economy and you. Public broadcasters from Maine, Vermont, and New Hampshire teamed up to share stories from communities throughout northern New England. We offer ideas, advice, and solutions to the financial and economic challenges facing you and your neighbors. We've collected an array of online tools and resources to enhance your financial literacy. On the program today, you'll see how people from a Stratham, New Hampshire neighborhood mobilized to save their homes.
People thought long term this was the best thing for us to do, to give us that sense of security.
You'll meet a woman from Leeds, Maine, who taught legions of fans how to live frugally.
I know that this works. I know it works. The core of my being, I know this works.
And you'll learn how to protect yourself from investment fraud. First, for a lot of people who are out of work, finding a job is painfully impersonal. The sheer loneliness and isolation of the process can cloud clear thinking. But Making Sense correspondent Bridget Barry Caswell met a group of people in Burlington, Vermont, who are helping each other clear a path toward employment and self-understanding.
For all too many New Englanders, economic recovery means finding a new job. Most begin their quest by searching the classifieds, but others have found an enlightened alternative. It's called Job Club, and it's working.
Being in a job at any given time can give you this feeling of security, but then it can change at a moment's notice.
Out-of-work financial advisor Tricia Sensel is typical of a new generation of job seekers who are turning their career interruptions into career-building opportunities.
I received a phone call letting me know that a riff and job cuts were coming at my company, and when I got back from vacation, I would no longer have a job. So, you know, what felt like security one day was gone a week later, and you just need to start picking up pieces over again. And then looking for a job becomes your full-time job. I quickly realized that all of the conventional methods of finding a job, looking through the classifieds ads or reading job opportunities on companies' websites, is mostly ineffective.
Well, I just wanted to follow up from our meeting last week.
It's about building the relationships and the connections, and oftentimes the jobs that are really available are built through relationships, not something you see posted in a classified.
Burlington's Ethan Allen Club has long been the domain of the area's most prosperous local movers and shakers, but leaner times have transformed one of the club's exclusive chambers into the headquarters of Smart DT, a resource for personal and professional healing, reinforcement, and transition.
Good morning and welcome to this October 19th meeting of Job Club Smart Vermont and the Bench.
Every Monday morning at 10 a.m. sharp, a dozen or more already or soon-to-be jobless professionals gather here to try to find their way back to work. An executive headhunter by trade and behaviorist by avocation, Mark Rankert, helped found Smart VT.
The first thing that happens when someone loses a job is people say, who am I? Now what? Our system treats it like combat fatigue. We will carefully counsel, coach, listen to, witness the wounded professional. At the same time, we do gentle nudges back to action.
Suddenly, finding out that you are unemployed and have been laid off really kind of stops your momentum dead in your tracks. I had to think about, okay, what are next steps in addition to figuring out what I needed to do to find my next job.
Smart VT essentially reinvents its members by immediately applying their skills to a virtual corporation in which everyone can claim a leadership position and a connection to the accomplishments of fellow members.
The model under which Smart Vermont works is to really identify in each of our participants what they bring to the table. And in my case, I am very passionate about sustainability, and by being appointed Chief Sustainability Officer of Smart Vermont, I'm doing everything I possibly can to live up to that fine title.
Smart VT is also big on building a personal arsenal of self-marketing and networking tools. It all begins with a nervous self-introduction.
Hello, I am Wendy Steger.
And before she knows it, what the new member thought was already a great resume is subjected to a frank and thorough critique.
It looks like you were simply a paper pusher, that you were managing the data that was coming in the files.
Which is inaccurate.
I suspect that you were actually meeting with the consumers themselves.
Even business cards get a close look. And if you don't have your own, this club will help you create one that introduces you as an employee of the company, known as Smart VT. Members are also urged to become active on a variety of social media in order to build and tap their own network of like-minded professionals.
The approach is helping bring your skills up to speed for deployment, either as a consultant or as an employee, and then as a leader of the job club, tying it all together, all moving towards employment.
Jeff Riando recently landed a lucrative job, which he says had everything to do with his job club experience.
Smart VT helped me develop my own marketing plan so that when I did make a connection to two companies and more than one company that was there, is I knew what I was going to say. I knew what my value was to that company.
It's very easy to get down and depressed in this type of situation. And it's positive because you're getting reinforcement from the people you're working with here. And you feel very good because you're helping other people yourselves. We're able to give to each other, share with each other, learn from each other. So it's a big uplift.
Make a new friend, land a job, or land a consulting opportunity. Whatever you do from that experience, a Smart VT person will walk away with two of those three things.
Of course, the preferred outcome is getting a job, maybe even one as good as Jesse Stein's. This recent Smart VT alum now works for one of the hottest young companies in Vermont.
Shifting your conversation from, I'm desperate, I need a job, to, I've got some skills and some value in this transaction as well. It's really what I got out of the job club. It's a sales job. It's all about you finding out what the needs are at a particular place and whether or not you've got the skills to fill that. How you work with people, whether you work with them in the same company or in a place like Smart Vermont or Job Club, really is something you take with you everywhere.
Smart VT members point out that job clubs aren't just for the unemployed. So if you're interested in expanding or restoring your career, contact a local job club or another professional networking association. For Making Sense New England, I'm Bridget Berry Caswell.
For more information on job clubs and professional networking, go to the Making Sense website at makingsensene.org. New Englanders are known for their frugality. Or are they? Amy Decision, who is well known for her publication, The Tightwad Gazette, says that frugality seems to move in and out of favor like the tide. I met with Amy at her home in Leeds, Maine, and I learned that being frugal pays dividends during good economic times and bad.
Oh, I know what I was going to show you. Funny things that I save. Most people save buttons, but I save these things off of kids. Overalls. I don't have little kids anymore, but I've got grandchildren who are going to be coming up, so I can replace any of those.
Amy Decision is giving a tour of her sewing room.
This was $8 at a yard sale.
Lots of the items here are from yard sales, like this $5 sewing machine. But some of them were even cheaper or free. Take these shelves.
A lot of this stuff I got secondhand, yard sale, junk shop, trash pick. This set of cubbies here I trash picked, And I was at the antique festival in Union, Maine, and I saw the exact same thing for $125. Oh, I wanted to show you my stereo system out here. I have two old computer speakers out here, and they're hooked up to one of my kids' old DVD players. And it works amazingly well, so I can play my radio.
Amy Decision is the self-proclaimed frugal zealot. From 1991 to 1996, she published the Tightwad Gazette, a newsletter devoted to frugal living. At its peak, it had 100,000 subscribers. Her anthology, The Complete Tightwad Gazette, keeps on selling 12 years after its first publication. Retired now, Decision says she still gets phone calls from time to time, especially when recessions hit, and that discourages her.
We always do think frugality in bad times, and I just wish people would do it in the good times, because if we would do it in the good times, the bad times wouldn't be bad. We'd be able to ride it out.
For Decision, frugality is not only about living beneath your means, but also living like a more affluent person by doing so.
I'll just give you one example. With one of my daughters, when she was 10, she wanted to get her ears pierced. So we went down and got her ears pierced, and I paid for that. That was part of her birthday. And then she wanted to spend the rest of her money buying another pair of earrings at the mall. And I said, oh, don't do that. I can get you earrings. Don't do that. So we put out the word and talk to relatives. Everybody's got some in their jewelry box they don't want anymore, and hit some yard sales and did some. And within a few months, she had 40 pairs of earrings in a little case that altogether we spent a few dollars on, under $5 for sure. So that's just one example that there are infinite number of ways to live richly and well, but it's about applying a lot of creativity to this whole process.
Her own house illustrates her point. It is a big, beautiful old Maine farmhouse in perfect condition, the stuff of dreams. The Decisions raised six kids here on one modest income. Clothes came from yard sales, food grown in the garden or bought in bulk.
Saving money on small things adds up. This is not about people having some emotional problem about money, obsessive compulsive, don't want to spend money thing. It's that little things add up. Little behaviors add up. You know, if you save $10 a week, that's over $500 a year.
Decision says it is never too late to start learning tightwad ways. Her advice, keep track of what you spend your money on.
Start writing down all the stuff, no matter how small. If you're putting a dime in a gumball machine, everything, I know it sounds like a ridiculous amount of work, but because little things is where you're losing the money, a lot of it. And write it down. If people would do this step, they don't need to buy my book. Because it is so obvious where they're making mistakes. It is so obvious. And by being honest with yourself and writing it down, you will start to spend less money simply because you don't want to write it down. Just in that act right there. But mostly it's looking at what you're doing and being really honest and evaluating at the end of the month and going like, who knew that going out to lunch at work every day was adding up to this much every month?
For Decision, saving money isn't just a way of life, it is kind of a game. Take this rule. Decision never spends more than $5 for a compact disc.
I mean, it's no fun if I'm just going to say, oh, I'm just going to spend $20 on CDs. It's more fun to, you know, see how cheaply I can do it and how good of a collection I can make. And it takes time, a little more work to do it, but it's fun.
Amy Decision has lived her life her way and found it liberating. She wants others to share the experience.
A year or two ago for Christmas, my daughter did me a drawing. My daughter has her own apartment now, and she did this drawing for me, and she framed it for Christmas. The post-college frugal apartment, and this is an illustration of her living room, and these are illustrations of all the things she did and where she got it from. And it's all cast-off stuff. Isn't that wonderful?
And how proud, Mom, does that make you?
I mean, on so many levels. And this actually was my daughter who was most likely to complain when she was young. I know that this works. I know it works. To the core of my being, I know this works.
Amy Decision stresses that frugality does not have to be extreme to be effective. Even small changes can help you take control of your finances. Our next story is about taking control of and avoiding potentially bad situations. Correspondent Phil Vaughn visited a neighborhood in Stratham, New Hampshire, where residents face the possibility of losing their homes. As you'll see, they didn't give in to the problem, but took control of it.
Though it may not look like it, the homes in this neighborhood arrived here on wheels.
It's a lovely little park aesthetically, and people see that when they come into the park.
Every day you pick up the globe.
Fran and Don Massey moved to Aberdeen Park in 1990. Newly retired, they wanted an affordable place to live after selling their home in nearby Durham.
When my husband retired in 89, we decided that, considering the decrease in the income, that we had to downsize.
23 families live here. Their homes are manufactured elsewhere and brought to the park in sections. Once in place, they're fastened and secured to concrete slabs. What's not secure is that in neighborhoods like Aberdeen, the homeowners are not necessarily the landowners.
Well, it was owned by the developer of the park, which was Aberdeen Realty, and we paid, a monthly lot fee for the maintenance of the park. And it stayed that way for 20 years, and, people felt very secure and comfortable.
20 years of security gave way to doubt in February 2009. That's when the residents of the park learned that the landowner had some news for them.
They decided to sell the park, and they obtained a purchase and sales agreement on it. It kind of, shook everybody up a bit because we were concerned as to, what the plans of the new owner might be.
The one thing they do know is that the rents will go up. They just don't know how much. And then there's lots of other pieces that they don't know. Does the owner have in mind to do something else with the property that would involve removing the homes?
Julie Eads is president of the Community Loan Fund, a nonprofit started in New Hampshire and now operating throughout New England.
The Loan Fund was created with two ideas. One is that some of the problems that people have aren't just because they have low incomes, but because they don't have access to capital. And the other theory was that there's capital out there. People own or manage capital, and they'd be willing to put it to use for basic human needs if they had a way to do it. So we were created as a way to get capital from where it is to where it might not go so easily.
The residents of Aberdeen learned they had an option: buy the land and form a cooperative. The Community Loan Fund guided them through the process.
Most homeowners, manufactured homeowners who live in parks, know now that they, when their park is up for sale, one of their choices is to buy it themselves, to organize themselves into a corporation, a cooperative corporation, and buy it. So that's what the folks at Aberdeen did. And then what happens is we walk them through the steps. They have to figure out what they think the budget's going to be, what kind of improvements are needed, and then they can figure out the financials of what it's going to cost them to do that.
It's, quite an involved process, and it's a real learning experience for all of us, that's for sure.
And what did you know about that beforehand?
Nothing. Really nothing, because it's, any one of us, we didn't know anything about it.
We didn't really know what to expect.
Despite that uncertainty, residents formed a board. Nancy Pierce is a member. She says she understood the magnitude of the task at hand and also realized the potential benefits.
I think we all just thought, well, is this a possibility? How can we possibly do this? And if we can do this, the biggest thing is we can control our own costs. We can be empowered to make the decisions, what we're going to spend the money on and what we're willing to spend the money on.
And how much time did you have to form the co-op?
Well, we had to submit a purchase and sales agreement to the owner in a 60-day period.
The board completed all the legal requirements to purchase the land their home stood on. They shopped around for a mortgage and found one through the Community Loan Fund.
As you might have noticed, the economy's a little uncertain right now, too. So in this situation, we end up providing the entire financing. They're working under a certain time pressure. And the banks are adding criteria, and their capital is more constrained. So the most affordable way for them to buy it in this situation was for us to finance the whole thing, and we did.
So now homeowners at Aberdeen are cooperative landowners, too. Rent is charged to take care of all the expenses, including the mortgage.
Their rents are the revenue that supports a mortgage. Anybody who bought that would use financing, and it would be paid for by their rents. And that's what a lot of homeowners don't realize. They are the economic engine of this little business that is a manufactured housing park.
And it's still a daunting experience. We're new and we're just beginning to understand what it's all about. I mean, it's one thing to purchase the property. It's another thing to maintain the property and learn all the different things that have to be done in that process.
It, opened our eyes, I guess, to not be so complacent, take things, for granted as we did, to be perhaps as comfortable as we were for a long period of time.
Perhaps the greatest lesson learned by the residents of Aberdeen Park is about the possibilities when action is taken.
It's a case where people thought long term this was the best thing for us to do, to give us that sense of security.
For Making Sense New England, I'm Phil Vaughn.
You'll hear more about the Community Loan Fund at the end of the program. But before we take you there, I recently met with U.S. Securities and Exchange Commissioner Elise Walter. We discussed some of the new ways criminals are stealing from investors like you. The commissioner offered some advice on how not to be a victim.
Commissioner Walter, thank you for joining us to talk about investment fraud.
It's a pleasure to be here.
I want to start with the first big, broad question. Just how prevalent is investment fraud?
Much too prevalent than we want it to be, much more so, but not as prevalent as people think it is. If you look at most of the people in the securities industry, they have a clean record. But of course, that doesn't matter to someone who's the victim of fraud and has their life savings wiped out, and we want to try to prevent all of that.
Have we seen any new trends in investment fraud that are connected with this recession? Are people targeted in different ways than they were before?
Investment fraud tends to follow what's going on in our lives. So, for example, the state securities administrator has issued a document to indicate the 10 hotspots for fraud, and they follow what's going on in the marketplace. So, for example, the real estate market has been hit very heavily. There's a lot of fraud involving mortgages and ways to kind of come back after mortgages. There's also a lot of natural resources fraud these days as people turn their attention towards commodities that seem to have real value. So you'll find that that's true. If you look in the newspapers, fraud will tend to follow what might be hot. As you and I were talking about a few minutes ago, wind is a big issue in Maine. So fraud involving wind turbines or windmills or ways to use alternative energy might be something that might crop up here.
So as an investor, if you're being pitched something that has a lot of relevance to your life because you're reading about this in the paper or your neighbor's involved in the industry, there's a higher risk that that might be a fraudulent investment.
Absolutely. And so what you need to do, as is always true with investments, is check it out very carefully. Always maintain a healthy degree of skepticism. Ask a lot of questions. Check out the investment professionals who are involved. Make sure that they're registered. And you can do that through the Maine Securities Administrator. You can do it through the SEC. You can do it through the Financial Industry Regulatory Authority. See if the securities themselves are registered. And make sure you understand what the terms of the securities are. And don't stop asking questions until you feel that you have a firm understanding.
Let me ask you about the gamut of investor fraud. You were using the phrase securities. Often people will think of a scam, maybe something they've gotten in an email. Does the SEC look at things that vary from scams to something with, a mutual fund firm or something like that?
Absolutely. What we're charged with doing, and that's the reason I use the term securities, is to deal with fraud that involves securities. But securities is a very broad range. It may be an ordinary share of common stock in a company as well known as Intel, say, for example, or a fixed income security, a bond or a note, or a security that technically is called an investment contract, which is basically the kind of thing that is not a traditional security, but, for example, where there's an asset that's put into a pool and people buy an interest in that asset, but not something they can walk away from. And those are not as traditional, not as well known. They are not necessarily fraudulent, but they present more risks than traditional investments.
For an extended version of the commissioner's interview, as well as bonus excerpts from other interviews conducted for today's program, visit our website at makingsensene.org. Thanks for watching Making Sense New England. I'm Jennifer Rooks.
What other programs does the Community Loan Fund offer?
The Loan Fund tries to make sure that people are and communities are able to do what they need to do to help include people in the economy. We have a program called Microcredit New Hampshire, which provides financing and education to self-employed people all over the state. Again, they're too small to fit into some of the government and bank systems that serve other businesses. So we're a specialty educator and financer in that area.
Major funding for the production of Making Sense New England has been made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting, the Foundation for Financial Planning, a nonprofit organization helping people take control of their financial lives through financial literacy education, and the pro bono outreach of the financial planning community. The FINRA Investor Education Foundation, helping investors ask questions and check investments before they invest. Online at saveandinvest.org. Goodwill, helping to stretch budgets since 1933. Online at goodwillnne.org.